Jim Stonegate. How are you? Everybody well? Good. Well, my name is Craig King. I'm one of the worship pastors here. It's so good to be with you today. If you're visiting with us, we want to welcome you on this Memorial Day weekend. And we'd love to know that you were here with us. So there's a little card right there in the seat back in front of you. And if you'll just fill that out, we'd love to know that you were here. You can turn that into the offering baskets as they come around, or you can go to the information desk. Somebody would love to meet you out there. So again, this is Memorial Day weekend, and we honor those that have served and have died fighting for our country. And I'm a grandson of two World War II veterans, and I was told the early service, I'd give anything to sit in front of them again and hear their stories. You know, as a snotty-nosed teenager, I thought I was way too cool for those stories. But I'd take anything right now to sit in front of Pawpaw and hear him tell some stories. And so today we remember what those men and women did. And you that have actively served, I want to thank you too. Because we get to do this out and open in public. And so may we never take that for granted. So do me a favor, let's stand to our feet this morning. And shake someone's hand around you. Make them feel welcome this morning. Introduce yourself to someone.
Worthy is the Lamb.
are good. When there's nothing good in me, you are love. You are love on display for all to see. You are light. You are light. When darkness closes in, you are hope. You are hope. You have covered all my sin. You are peace, you are peace. When my fear is crippling, you are true, even in my wandering. You are joy, you're the reason that I sing. You are life, in your death and loss is deep. And I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world forever. You are more, you are more. My words will ever say, you are Lord, all creation will proclaim. You are here, in your presence I'm made whole. You are God, of all else I'm letting go. And oh, I'm running to your arms. Your arms, the riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world forever reign. I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world forever reign. My heart will sing no other name. verse says, my sin, oh, the bliss, and not in part, my sin, not in part, not just some of them, but all of them, nailed to a cross, and we bear them no more. See, as believers, that's what we celebrate today. That's what the truth we're awakened to this morning, that we're reminded of once again. My sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious God. My sin, not in part, but the whole, was not just a song, God, but that we would actually mean that and know that. That, Father, whatever may come, whatever we may not have our mind completely wrapped around, Father, that we in our heart, our soul can say that it is well. Because you died, you were crucified, because you rose again and defeated death and the grave. It is well with our soul today. We love you. It's in Jesus' name. Amen. You may have a seat. We're going to teach you a new one today, and it goes a lot along those lines, too, as we try to make sense of situations and circumstances around us. Sometimes we just have to have joy in the midst of. My heart is torn asunder, and my world just falls apart. Lord, you put me back together and lift me up to where you are. There is hope beyond the suffering, joy beyond the tears.
peace in every tragedy, love that conquers fear. I have found redemption in the blood of Christ. My body may be dying, but I'll always be alive. You have turned morning to dancing. You have covered me with rain. The struggle here may last a moment, but life with you will last away. There is hope beyond the suffering, joy beyond the tears, peace in every tragedy, a love that conquers fear. I have found redemption in the blood of Christ. My body may be dying,
joy in all circumstances. God, the enemy has tried to steal from us, yet we remain joyful this morning. Thank you for the hope that you've given us in your Son, Jesus Christ. God, as we open up your word, may it breathe life into us this morning. It's in Jesus' name.
Well, good morning, everyone. How's it going? Y'all doing okay? I've been instructed to stay on my pink X, so I'm trying to do so, trying to practice early. Well, welcome. My name's Dustin. Whether you're here in Midland or in Odessa, we just want to say thank you for spending your day with us, and we love you guys. You're part of our family, so thank you. Let's kind of start our time together this way. Being Memorial Day weekend, I don't want to just run over that fact. I do want to honor those who have given their life and sacrificed for this country. I also want to thank those who have served or who are still actively serving. So if we could we just celebrate them with a round of applause real quick? Just some love. Awesome. And kind of a cool tidbit to hang on the backside of that. So last week we had Honor Our Troops here. And Honor Our Troops, because of your support, they were able to assemble and send out 300 boxes to servicemen and servicewomen overseas to help aid them and show them love as they continue in their sacrifice for our country. So really, really cool how it all kind of tied together there in the Lord's timing. But again, for anyone who served, thank you for your service. And we want to honor your life today. So very cool. Well, we're going to press the pause button on kind of our regularly scheduled journey through Ezra and Nehemiah. Patrick's obviously out. He'll be back next week. But what we want to do today is to spend a little bit of time focusing on one of our core values as a church, which just so happens to also be a biblical responsibility we have, and that's to empower the next generation. So we're going to look at what does it really mean to pour our life into the life of the next generation. And we're going to look at why that's a core value for Stonegate, show you some practical things that Stonegate's doing to flesh that value out, but really hopefully drill into the fact that, man, this is a biblical responsibility we have to give our life to the lives of those coming up beneath us. You know, I've thought a lot lately about who are the fans in my life, like not who are the people who are like, you're so great, but the people who have championed my life, like who are the spiritual fans that I have? And I've thought of a few people. Think of a guy named Gary Bierce, kind of like Pierce, but with a B. And Gary was my RA leader. Who knows RAs? Boom, Christian Boy Scouts. Okay. So Gary led us in RAs, and we'd go to this place called Highland Lakes, and we'd make Pinewood Derby cars, and we'd get around the bonfire and shoot stuff like targets, and it was awesome. But I was a punk kid. And Gary would say things like, don't drink the Kool-Aid, and I'd drink the Kool-Aid. And Gary would say things like, hey, when we do our skit tonight, take it serious. And I would make an offhanded comment to make people laugh, and I was that guy. But Gary showed me patience. He showed me grace. He forgave me. And from Gary, I learned that we can learn a lot about God through creation. And I can say, man, Gary Bierce, he raised me. I think of Brother Carl Riley. I cannot say his name without putting brother in the front, okay? Anyone feel me on that? Have you been there? Brother Carl was my pastor growing up. I grew up in a very small church, about 150 people. And Brother Carl always smiled from ear to ear, most encouraging man I've ever known. I can't tell you a word of what he preached on. But here's what I can tell you. Brother Carl loved people. And when I graduated high school, he gave me a book about my identity in Christ, and I still have it 17 years later because Brother Carl taught me what it means to invest in the next generation. And I can tell you this with a clear conscience, Brother Carl raised me. Outside of the church, I think of guys like Chuck Schwanekamp. Picture a big grizzly guy who spits a lot and coaches football. Woo, we don't know anything about that out here, right? Coach Schwanekamp was my football coach, Plainfield, Indiana, and I had this little disease called the late bloomer effect. Rob was like that little guy that you could like pick up and pet because I was so small. And because of that, it kind of stunted any dreams I have of, you know, athletic glory. And I'll never forget the day when Coach Schwanekamp said, Pierce, puts his arm around me and goes, this is just life. He goes, Pierce, do you shave yet? And I was like, no. I didn't want to tell him, I don't have armpit hair either. But what he said next, I'll never forget. He said, Pierce, because of things that you cannot control, you're probably not going to play on this football team. But I love you, son, and I believe something big is going to happen with your life. Through that caring conversation, he taught me what it means to be a man who still talks about tough stuff in a way that makes sense. And I could tell you this, Coach Schwanekamp, he raised me. Then I got to get into my mom and dad. I mean, they kind of had a part in that too, right? Wink, wink. You know, mom always taught me not to speak negative words against myself or other people. I'll never forget where she would be like, don't say that. Do not speak that. Do not. And then she'd follow it up by, you only speak things in the name of Jesus. And that stuck with me. My mom, she's raised me. Think about my dad who taught me the power of the choices we make and the responsibility we have to make choices that honor Jesus. And I've watched my dad grow from like the guy who just grew his kids up in church, you know what I mean? To the guy who followed Jesus and shepherded his kid's heart. Oh man, I could cry. My dad's raised me. He's chased after my heart in ways I can't even talk about. Then I think about my grandmother. She taught me in my 20s when I was playing this silly dating game that, hey, Dolly, which is what she calls me, I don't know why. Hey, Dolly, I'm still, even as I say it out loud, I'm like, that is weird. But she's a grandma, and grandmas do what grandmas do. And so she said, have you ever thought about praying to see people the way that God sees them? Because the way you're doing it's not working. And I'm like, And quickly, I learned a perspective, an aha moment. My grandma, man, she raised me. And I'll stop with Papa. I could go on and on, but I'll stop with Papa. Papa taught me how to love. Papa was always writing notes. Papa was always making poems. He died when I was a senior in high school. And before he died, or actually after he died, pre-funeral, I'm going through some stuff. And I found a poem that Papa had written me when I was an 8 or 9 year old boy. And this is what he said. Dusty is a Papa's boy. Guessed he always will. And when he comes to my house, oh my, what a thrill. Every time I see him, it sets my heart a-racing. I sure do love old Dusty and his brother Jason. And I say that to say that my papa loved. And as cheesy as that may come across, as an 8-year-old boy, 18-year-old man, and 35-year-old man, that resonates with me. Last story about Papa, he was 6'4", and toward the end of the life, cancer kind of riddled his body, you know, but he was still serving as a prison guard in Colorado City. And I'll never forget one day as a young kid, I don't know how old I was, but I looked out and my Papa was in his prison guard outfit with like the 65,000 ounce jug of iced tea from All Sips, you know, those that you just refill and you play like a better price. And he was just walking like this, just walking around the country farm. And I asked my grandmother, I said, what is he doing? And she said, oh, sweetheart, he's just taking a walk with Jesus. He's just taking a walk with Jesus. He's just talking and walking. And my papa taught me not only how to love, but how to have an intimate relationship with Jesus outside of church. Here's what I know. I know that every single person that is in this room today can share a similar story. Guarantee it. Names changed, story same. Whether you're a kid in this room, whether you're a teenager, whether you're single, whether you're married with kids, married without kids, grandma, grandpa, great-grandma, great-grandpa, and any other identifier in between, every single one of us has a responsibility to be a fan like that. We all have the responsibility to pour our life into the life of the next generation. Mom and dads, a lot of you in this room have kids and you think, well, this is mine. I just focus on these two or three little knuckleheads. Well, I'll tell you the truth. Mom and dad aren't called to do it alone, but nor are you called to just focus on your own. Let me tell you a truth I hope you never forget, and it's this. We all have the responsibility to raise up the next generation to repeat and not repeat after us. Every single one of us has a responsibility, regardless of where we are, to raise up those coming behind us to repeat some things and to not repeat some things. That's the mandate on our life. It's biblical. And I want to show you that. You know, the Bible speaks towards generations almost 200 times in Scripture. I could give you all kinds of scripture about what it means to be someone who pursues the next generation, chases after the next generation, is a fan of the next generation, whatever language you want to use. But I'm going to choose one that has just been at the core and the center of Stonegate from the very, very beginning, and that's Psalm 78. So if you would take your Bible and go to Psalm 78, and here's what we're going to learn. Every single person is created in the image of God and placed in a specific period of time to use their time to pour into those whose time is coming. every person is created in the image of God and is given and placed in a specific period of time to use their time to pour their life into the lives of people whose time is coming. That's the biblical mandate, and we're going to explore that today in Scripture. Please know, really, I made the mistake at 9 o'clock. I tried to do too much. No one's ever tried to do that before, right? All right, just me. So I tried to do too much at 9. I'm going to try to keep it simple and concise here at 10 and just kind of give you one as we look at Psalm 78. And let me read this to you, and then we'll break it down, maybe do some different things to make it come alive. Then I'm going to show you some things that practically you can do to flesh this out. Then I'm going to tell you about what Stonegate's doing, and then Mom and Dad, have I got something for you. It's coming, okay? But first, Psalm 78. Here's what it says. My people, hear my instruction. Listen to the words from my mouth. I will declare wise sayings. I will speak mysteries from the past, things we've heard and known and that our fathers have passed down to us. We will not hide them from their children, but will tell a future generation the praiseworthy acts of the Lord, his might, the wondrous works that he's performed. He established a testimony in Jacob. He set up a law in Israel. He commanded our fathers to teach their children, underline, underline, circle, circle, so that a future generation, children yet to be born, might know. They were to rise and to tell their children so that they might put their confidence in God, not forget God's works, but keep his commands. Then they would not be like their fathers, a stubborn, rebellious generation, a generation whose heart was not loyal and whose spirit was not faithful to God. A guy named Asaph is writing this psalm, and he's a choir master, musician kind of a guy. But what he's doing is he's looking back on his history. This is a historical psalm. And from verse 9 all the way through, is it 72 or 74? Through 72, he talks about how his people have done this and have twisted and turned and followed God and turned and followed God and turned and spoken to the next generation and forgot about him and all of this stuff. And what he urges them to do is to remember who they are, whose they are, and what their purpose is here. And he uses history as kind of like a setting, a foundation, to help them see that the calling on their life, their responsibility, is to empower those that are coming up behind them so that those coming up from behind them can lead well, love well, and make much of the kingdom of God. And he doesn't say, only do this if you're a mom or dad. He doesn't say, only do this if you are, you know, someone who's teaching in the temple. He says, this is what we're supposed to do. And we'll break this down verse by verse here in just a moment. But I want you to know in this first verse where it says, my people hear my instructions and listen to the words from my mouth. The original hearers here, they would have known the word listen to mean something a little bit different. The word listen carried so much weight with them. They grew up in a culture where this word listen didn't just mean that you hear, you actually put into action the things that are spoken. So I stumbled across a tool that has really helped me in my Bible study. And let me share this tool with you today that is going to help this word listen make more sense so that we can trace the history of the people of Israel, better understand this calling to the next generation, and then practically apply it to the 21st century. Check out this tool I found.
For thousands of years, every morning and evening, Jewish people have prayed these well-known words as a way of expressing their devotion to God. They're called the Shema. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. And as for you, you shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your strength. Now the first word of the Shema is hear, or listen, which in Hebrew is pronounced Shema. That's where the prayer gets its name. Now, Shema is a really common word in the Hebrew Bible, and it's obvious why. Hearing is a very universal activity. It's usually connected with the ear, as in Proverbs chapter 20. Ears that Shema and eyes that see, the Lord has made them both. Now that seems basic enough, but if you look at the other ways that Hebrew authors can use the word Shema, they use it to mean more than just let sound waves enter your ear. In Hebrew, Shema can also mean pay attention to or focus on. So when Leah, who wasn't loved by her husband Jacob, she has a son and she names him Simon, or in Hebrew, Shimon, because she says, the Lord has Shama'at that I am unloved. So Shema means to hear and to pay attention to, and even more. It can also mean responding to what you hear. This is why so many of the cries for help in the book of Psalms begin with a call that God listen. Psalm 27, verse 7. Shema my voice when I call, O Lord. Be merciful. Answer me. So asking God to Shema is at the same time asking God to act, to do something. It's similar to when God asks people to listen. Like when the people of Israel come to Mount Sinai, God says, if you Shema me fully and keep my covenant, then out of all the nations you will be my treasured possession. Now there's a couple interesting things about this verse in Exodus. In Hebrew, the word Shema is repeated twice in this sentence to give it emphasis. If you Shema Shema, meaning listen closely. But also notice that from God's point of view, listening is basically the same as keeping the covenant. So when God asks the people to Shema, what he means is that they listen and obey. And that's the last fascinating thing about Shema. In ancient Hebrew, there is no separate word for obey, meaning to carry out the wishes of someone who knows better than you or is in authority over you. So in the Bible, if you want to say, I will listen and do what you say, you use the single word, Shema. In Hebrew, listening and doing are two sides of the same coin. This is why later in Israel's history, when the people were breaking their covenant promises to God, the Hebrew prophets would say things like, they have ears, but they're not listening. The Israelites, of course, could hear just fine, but they weren't actually listening, or else they would act differently. And so in the end, listening in the Bible is about giving respect to the one speaking to you and doing what they say. Real listening takes effort and action, and that's the Hebrew word Shema.
Awesome. So I totally spilled water on me, so I'm sorry if that's a distraction. Happened in between. I'm like, oh no, it's happening. So Asaph's writing to a people, a Hebrew people. And what he's telling them is he's telling them, you need to listen to what I'm saying. He's saying, guys, listening is part of what we've grown up with. We've grown up with this mindset that we're supposed to hear and put into action, this mindset of impressing things on our children's hearts, of literally making a mark on our children's hearts as we teach them about God. We've grown up knowing that we're supposed to sharpen our kid almost like a weapon so that we can send them out into battle. So he's saying, Shema here, listen, hear what's about to come out of my mouth. So I think it's so important to see that historical context, and you would know that people hearing this for the first time, they would kind of be like, ding, they would light up a little bit, carried a little more weight than maybe what it carries with us. And here's what he tells them to listen, to pay attention to, and to focus on. He says, I'm going to declare some wise sayings. I'm going to speak some mysteries from the past, things that we've heard and known that our fathers have passed down. In other translations, he talks about speaking in parables. And really all he means by that, a parable, not necessarily how Jesus taught them. Parable here is more a story laid side by side with another story in order to compare. So it's the ability to compare like Israel's past with their present kind of a deal. And that's what he's doing. And then in other translations, mysteries, he talks about uttering dark phrases. And really what he says is, look, I'm going to tell you some stories of our past and present. Let me tell you what else I'm going to tell you. I'm going to tell you some of the bad stuff. I'm going to tell you some of the junk drawer stuff. I'm going to tell you some of the dirty, so to speak. He goes, but I'm doing it all under the mindset that you will listen, pay attention, and see that you have a mandate, a responsibility to pour your life into the next generation. That you are called to raise up the next generation to repeat and not repeat. And so he goes into the classic verse, which is verse number 4. Now he's talking about passing things down. In verse 4, he talks about this is what you're passing down. You know, if you go to the kids' info desk, this scripture is there on kind of like a little plaque thing. And then up on the wall, some artists drew this out in a beautiful, beautiful way. But this is so much more than a mural. so much more than decor for the wall. This is a supernatural moving of God in which we get to be a part of the movement. And watch what he says here. He says, okay, you Shema, you listening? You focusing? You paying attention? Okay, we've covered this before in history. Let's try it again. We can't hide from our children what God has done, the good, the bad on our part. We can't hide it from our children, but we must tell a future generation the praiseworthy acts of the Lord. Those who are coming up from behind us, we have to help them see that God is the uncreated creator who's performed praiseworthy deeds from the beginning of time until this very day. May 28th, 2017. God has done things that are consistent with his character, that are consistent with who he says he is, and he shows up every single time and enacts his plan. This is who God is. Regardless of what generation you were placed in, you have a mandate on your life to help those coming behind you to see the praiseworthy acts of God. And then to see his might. And that just doesn't mean like show them that God flexes or something. It's the mindset that show them that God is in control, that he is the authority of all things, and that this uncreated creator who's holding all things together, that he is in control. And he causes things to shift and to move, and he keeps things in orbit. This is God. And this is the God we're to be sharing with the next generation. But I wonder, and I'm sure Asaph wondered as well, is this the God we're showing the next generation? So bigger picture, we're to tell the story of reality to those who are learning reality. We're to tell the big story of God and who he is and what he's done and how he's working to kids who kind of woke up one day and are born into a story that they don't even really know what's going on. We get to tell them about that. By passing on the praiseworthy acts of the Lord, by teaching about his might, and by showing them the wondrous works he's performed. Every single one of us who's a follower of Jesus, who surrendered our life, can look back and start to list out and point to the miracles that he's performed. We've got to be people that expose the miracles that God's performed in our life to the next generation and help them see that although you can't see, touch, or feel him, he's real and alive, and here's how he's manifested himself in my life, in my legacy, in my family. We all have a mandate on our life to do that. And then Asaph just goes on to remind us that, you know, there's been a testimony established in Jacob, a law set up in Israel. God has a big story. And that might sound like whatever language to you, but God has a big story, and we play a role in that. And we have to know that and understand that and teach that. He goes on to say he's commanded us things from Deuteronomy 6 all the way through to teach our children so that a future generation and even those yet to be born, even those who still haven't said wah or breathed breath in their lungs, they are people whom we're preparing ourselves to empower and to raise up and to teach them what to repeat and what not to repeat. They were to rise and tell their children, and here's the beautiful part. I love it when scripture does that. So that, why is it so important to empower the generation, to help them see who God is, to listen and to pay attention and to focus on that? We do it so that they might put their confidence in God. So that they'll literally take their confidence and they'll assign it to God and not to some fleeting promise of the world. That's a cheat substitute. So that they will not forget God's works. So that they will understand that they're not just some random person that was birthed in a time where they had to follow some invisible God, but this uncaused creator who's in control of all things, who was and is and always will be, is running the show and has been from the very beginning. Then he goes on to say, so that they'll keep his commands, so that they'll actually see that this same God they can follow out of a heart of love, not a fear, rule keeping, stuff like that. And I love verse 8, just because it's kind of like him just reminding them, again, just the hard lessons of the past. He goes, then they would not be like their fathers, a stubborn, rebellious generation, a generation whose heart wasn't loyal, whose spirit wasn't faithful to God. And in the end, he's reminding us that when we commit to raise up the next generation to repeat and not repeat, the things that we help them to repeat are to be faithful, to be loyal, not perfect, faithful and loyal to this God who's been working from the beginning of time, is working now, and will continue to work when we're long gone. This is the God we have to show the next generation. So let me ask you a question. And here's the question. I'm going to put it on the screen. If the next generation were sitting next to me, and don't be the wise guy and be like, my kid is. More big picture. More big picture. Whether you're a kid, a teenager, college student, young adult, married adult, anything in between. Hypothetically, if the next generation were sitting next to me, what would be my next step? What am I going to do with my life if what Asaph writes is truth, and we believe it is, if the history of Israel was all centered around this idea of paying attention and focusing so that we can pour, then what's our next step? I'll tell you a couple, and they don't involve serving in kids' ministry, although that's a great one too. But let me tell you a couple of things that I think can really help, and they're going to sound simple. But I think sometimes we have to reframe the conversation that we have with the next generation. I believe sometimes we think we can only reach the next generation if we're the Sunday school teacher or if we're there on a Sunday or Wednesday night. Those are very important pieces to the puzzle, absolutely. But our lens has to be through Scripture. How can we see the next generation in all the things that we do? And as we come alongside those who are coming up underneath us, how do we pour our life into them? Let me give you a couple of simple things, but I think they're huge things. Here's the first one. We have to repeat the story of God to the next generation over and over. And it has to be beyond just like, God loves me, ask Jesus in your heart, he'll punch your ticket to heaven. It needs to be so much bigger and deeper and meatier and grander and glorious than that. They've got to see the big story of God working throughout all of creation. A God who designs people in his image to carry out his work. But while we're repeating the story of God, we've got to be someone who's modeling a whole body love for God. We love him here, we love him here, and we love him deep inside the parts of us that we can't put our fingers on. We love him with everything we are, this undivided love. And because of this undivided love, we're sharing the big story of God to the next generation. And it's not us sitting down having circle time. We weave it into the conversations. We weave it into the way we walk with them. And we show them that each and every one of them and one of us plays a role in the story. Our end game is not to sit in a building and then to come back and do it again a week from now. Our end game is to go out into the places we've been placed and to help people see this God and live for him as we put our skills and the way that we've been wired on display to his glory. So here's the next one. I want you to see this. This one's very important as well. When we are telling the story of God, here are the questions we've got to answer. Sometimes we tell the story of God and we leave out some key plot lines. Here's some key plot that needs to be included in this story. Because again, this isn't like Goldilocks and the Three Bears story. This is the story of reality. This is the story of how we came to be and what our life's really about. So we have to help the next generation answer these questions. They gotta know, in light of God's big story, where they come from. And the fact that something went wrong with the world, regardless of belief, regardless of what you would claim, I'm almost certain everyone can agree that something went wrong with the world. And so we have to help the next generation answer that. And we have to help them see that the solution is not in earthly form, that the solution is Jesus. And that Jesus didn't come to punch tickets and to just pat people on the shoulder. He came to transform and change hearts, minds, souls, families, legacies, trajectories, current generations, next generations, and everything in between. This is who he is. But we have to help him see it differently. He rescues, he redeems, and he frees. This is the Jesus whom I want to point the next generation to. Because then he gives purpose. And then he shows us that in the end, we all live forever somewhere. That's part of the big story of God. Here's the last practical thing that we can do, and we'll put it on the screen. So if you want to snap a picture or whatever, I'm cool with that. We've got to put scripture in front of the next generation and help them see that faith is personal, but it's never private. That, yeah, faith is very personal. You're wrestling with the story of reality and who you are, but it's not meant to be kept inside of a locked room or in a building one day of the week. It's meant to be lived out in your neighborhood, in your city, in your world. Ah, that's important. That's really, really important. So let's let this linger for just a minute so everyone can write that down and make sure that they get that. And let me tell you how Stonegate is coming alongside you and what we're going to do to ensure that this mindset that we all have a responsibility to raise up the next generation to repeat, not repeat after us. Here's some things that we're going to do. First and foremost, we've taken our kids' ministry and our youth ministry and we've combined them and made them one. And what that's showing is that from birth through cap and gown, we're coming for you. We're going to champion you. We're going to love you. Yeah, they're going to have separate programmings and things like that. But we don't see it as kids and youth. We see it as next gen. That is our hope. That is our heart. That's what we're coming after. So we would kind of say it this way, and I'll move to the next slide, that we hope to help the next generation and those who lead them. We want them to experience the transformation of Jesus, and we want them to become all they're designed, called, and gifted to be. We want them to live out what it means to be an image bearer of the King. We want them to realize that their life's about something bigger than themselves and that they've got all kinds of giftings and wirings and really unique things inside of them. We want to bring it to the surface because we have a responsibility to raise up the next generation to repeat, not repeat after us. Here's some things we'd love to repeat. What we want them not to repeat is just to coast and think it's okay to punch a ticket, pray a prayer, and just be not on our watch. So what's our strategy? Well, this is what we're going to do. We're going to come after some folks this way. Our hope is to help kids and students connect to trustworthy adults through five fans. We want every single kid who comes from our kids' ministry to our youth ministry to have five fans along the way. People who aren't just praising them for how great they are, but people are championing them for how great God is and telling them to follow him. I want a kid at his senior banquet to be able to address the crowd with honesty and conviction and go, boom, 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 boom. These people spoke into my life along the way. Here's something I want you to do real quick. If you're taking notes, and I hope you are. Who were your five fans growing up? Can you write that down? Do you have five people? Write it down right now as you're thinking. Write it down right now as you're just kind of taking this stuff in. Who are the five people who came up beside you and said, we are going to raise you up. You're the next generation. There's some things we want you to repeat. There's some things not so much. We want to help you see God's big story. We want to help you see that your life is about your neighborhood, your city, your world. And here's another question. Would any of your names be on somebody in this room's list? We all have a responsibility to pour our life into the next generation. And the way we're going to continue working that is we want to help students grow in a small group community through spiritual disciplines. And ultimately, we want to help them live a life of influence and see that neighborhoods, cities, and worlds matter. Although we often go, I hate Midland, it's this, it's that, it's the other. We're here on purpose, for purpose. I don't live on San Pedro Court because God liked the way it came out of my mouth when I roll my R's. It's a real thing. I'm there for a purpose. Alongside this, we're also really going to run after and champion you, Mom and Dad. Here's what we know. If we're to put five fans in the life of a kid, if we're to really change the conversation that everyone's responsible for pouring into the next generation, we know, Mom and Dad, you really need some things at home to sink your teeth into, some really practical things. So I'm hoping something like this will help.
From the day your child is born to the day they graduate, you have 936 weeks. 936 weeks of soccer practice and homework, and teaching them to use deodorant. 936 weeks to instill values, to build character, and to prepare them to face the world. You want to be a great parent, and we're here to help with each moment of parenting goal. Driving your fourth grader to practice. Saying goodbye to your 10th grader as he's walking out the door. Eating tacos in the kitchen with your 7th grader, tucking your toddler in at night. These moments happen every week, and we want you to be aware of the time you have left, because when you are, you do more with the time you have now. We cue you with easy, just-in-time ideas of things to say, things to do, and things to think about to connect with the heart of your child. Our cues are grounded in God's big story, so your child can discover the power of faith in those everyday moments of life. Every cue fits the context of your child's developmental phase. We cue you when your high schooler won't leave their room, your middle schooler won't pick up their clothes, your two-year-old won't stop talking. We help you understand these moments, and we help you connect. You only have 936 weeks. You can't afford to waste them. Parent Cue, it's what we do. Download it for free today.
We'll put the app right behind us on the screen. And I would invite every single person right now, please download the app. Take out your phone, download this app. Here's the thing. I'm not a mom yet. I'm a grandma. I'm a grandpa. I'm an aunt. I'm an uncle. I'm a whatever. Repetition is a good thing. We can all come behind these kids and speak life in this Parent Cue app. Really, it's just real tangible, practical application to help flesh out these principles. A Psalm 78. You know, each and every single generation, they've got to remember who they are, whose they are, and what their purpose is. And our hope is to speak into that in a way that's more cohesive than we've ever done before. To help people see that whether it's through sports, academics, hunting and fishing, church, work, whatever it may be, that they can invest in the next generation, raise them up, and help them to repeat and not repeat. My hope, honestly, is that more Gary Bierces come out of this room, more Brother Carls, more Chuck Schwanekamps, more moms and dads who love their kids and lead them well, but also realize they have a responsibility to others, papas and grandmothers. I'm going to leave you with a quote from a late great preacher, and I love this. This is what he said. His name's James Montgomery Boyce. He said, "We deserve nothing, yet we've received everything. Don't forget it. Remember God's blessings, remember his mercy, and remember to tell the next generation too." Let's pray. Father, I thank you for who you are. Thank you for this time. May the truths of Psalm 78 resonate in ways that only you can take credit for. Amen. As you're heading out, let me tell you two other practical things you can do. Number one, you can grab one of these and you can commit to praying for one of our kids who's going to one of our next generation camps next week and the week after, so please do that. And then tonight at 5 in the building right behind me, the U-shaped building, no! We've got a prayer time from 5 to 6. Love you guys. Get out of here. We'll see you later.